All right, super fantastic. The day after, and just to report in, I'm still alive, believe it or not. The fear is that if you're going to give out information that's never been heard before in this world, the fear is that there's a reason why it's never been heard, that anyone who has tried to say this has perished. This is the logic we use to say, well, if nobody's ever said this before, you can't possibly be the first one. Others must have tried, but since it's never gotten out in the world, it must be because they perished. So it's completely taboo to say this, completely taboo. So this is the difficulty in going first. It's not easy to go second or third either, or follow either. It's much more difficult to go first, but following is not easy because you think, well, maybe they were lucky. Maybe they had a special dispensation, the one who went first. But me said, no, following is the taboo, you know. So it's very difficult all the way around. But going first, certainly, there's enormous pressure and fear and concern because you say, why hasn't this been spread throughout the world, this information? Not at all. Well, those who've tried must have perished. You know, they must have just not even, you know, words are out of their mouth and that's it. So, it's very stressful, to say the least. Quite adventurous. Let me dial this up a little bit. But once it's been said, and once there are some that begin following along and saying, yeah, it gets easier for everybody else. They start saying, hey, maybe I won't perish if I believe this, if I look at this. Maybe I won't die. Maybe there isn't some terrible taboo. So there's an implicit assumption that if there's a certain information that has never been given out, and we say, well, we've been here for thousands and thousands of, you know, so long, and this has never been said, spoken of, well, then there must be some, you know, something drastic must, you know, something wrong in saying it. Some result will be terrible. You know, there's this implicit assumption, and so we just have to say no. That it's simply that we had not worked through the continuity fear and spent enough effort at it first. So for me, the only way I can do it is the fact that I've worked at this for so long with such tremendous intensity that I realize how difficult it is to get to here, and the problem is just the difficulty of it, not that there's some taboo. Whereas if I just tried to, just off the top of my head, say this, I'd say, whoa, wait a minute, you know, that's too easy. Maybe there is a taboo. So I can always describe the, you know, the situation to just, it's very difficult to get to this point. But yeah, there is this inner reverberation of like, uh-oh, what did I just say? Yeah, am I going to survive the night and the next day? Completely reevaluating, you know, Christianity, Jesus, the whole situation here. Total new paradigm. End of the church age. All this stuff's coming out, the apocalypse, and you say, wow. Is this God angry? Well, the imaginary God of guilt is angry for sure, but that there is no such God actually. It's just our imagination. We just invented it out of thin air so that there'd be someone to acknowledge that we did die. So spirit did die. Spirit's trying to die in order to prove that God died too, and then it invented to say, oh, if I died, there'll be no one to know that I died. God will be gone, I'll be gone. So let me invent this other God who's able to, who won't die. If I die and God dies, there'll still be this God, something left, which will be able to judge. Oh yes, the death and spirit did die, and therefore God died, and therefore spirit was able to kill God. Therefore spirit has the greater will, so spirit wins, and therefore spirit gets to resurrect from the dead and be the new prime creator. We just invented this imaginary judge. Okay, there isn't any real judge at all. So this imaginary judge, of course, that it's going to be, well, I haven't heard from it, and I don't want to because it's imaginary. There's nothing to hear at all, you know. So, but others will think, oh my gosh, I'm so afraid. I can't listen to this. No, I'm shutting down because they haven't done the work. If you've really done the work and put in the discipline, then you realize this is just the next step on the path. That's all. Just the next step. And so there isn't any really reason to fear it. But there still is a backlash of inner strain, and so you need to, just listening to it, you need to take a rest. And you say, wow, get some comfort food, get some chips and dip, some ice cream, whatever is your comfort food, a little comfort music, a little comfort graphics, a little comfort food, and just kind of reassure yourself that life is still good for you, at least you're still alive, and the boogeyman did not get you, or the boogie woman. And you haven't heard that often, the boogie woman. In fact, never heard it before. But it bears saying, doesn't it? In today's day and age, where we are giving an absolute blank check to the woman, to the femininity, complete blank check. Whatever you want to do is okay. But so don't leave out the boogie woman out of that. You have to keep yourself balanced, you know. Otherwise, you'll get way out of balance and thinking, and you go into goddess worship and thinking that this is your salvation, that somehow the goddess can bring about an authentic death. See, this is our hope. See, the God judge that we've invented has not been able to prove to that God judge that our authentic death. So then we send the goddess to this God judge to convince the God judge that, you know, what do you need here to be convinced that spirit really died? You can just let us know and you know, to make a deal. And the goddess comes back and says, okay, this is what the God judge told me, and this is what you're going to do. And say, okay, goddess, whatever you say, you know the way. We're desperate to have an authentic death. And of course, no such conversation ever took place. Well, imaginary conversation took place, but the God judge doesn't know what we need to do to die a authentic death, because we can't. How do we know how to do the impossible? We do not. So this idea that we send the goddess to get the information that we just don't know how to do it. We've been trying for so long, we just can't get an authentic death. And then she comes back and says, oh yeah, I know how, the God judge told me. No, that's not true. The God judge just said, I don't know. Just tell him anything, you know, whatever you want to say. He goes, oh, okay, I'll just tell him that you told me. He says, oh yeah, sure, whatever works. And so the goddess comes back to, oh yeah, I know, the God judge told me how to die an authentic death, and I'm gonna, so if you just do exactly what I say, yeah, this is what'll work. So blank check. We're given a blank check. Also, the technology, largely blank check. Speaking of technology, you know, it's a pipe dream to think that anybody can roll back technology on this planet at this point. There is no way that is going to happen. No possible way. It is completely embedded in the fundamental structure now of civilization and society. All the money is controlled by technology, distribution of food, production of food, roboticism, cars. There's nothing that isn't, it's heavily embedded, hardly. There is no leader that any of the world could elect that could actually roll back technology. The tech companies really are the most powerful force in the world right now, because they could just say, oh, you know, you don't want us here. You're going to put restrictions. I don't think so. We're going to throw a bunch of code in there and mess everything up for you. We're going to crash the stuff. You know, we're going to collapse civilization if you try to do that. So the idea of, you know, electing anybody leader, as if somehow they're going to be able to roll back technology, again, it is not going to happen. There's zero chance of that ever happening right now. Impossible. So, how do we deal with technology? Let's say we don't want a technological future, live in a technocracy, which I certainly am not going to live in a technocracy. So we have to start examining our options, and this is why it's so important to hear truth and listen to it. And it's very brave for anyone to listen to this, okay? Very courageous, and you have to be very disciplined to listen to truth in full stop on the wow. Otherwise, you're going to come unglued at some point. You're going to suddenly panic and say, wait a minute, I might get punished for this. God might be, the God judge might punish me. The goddess might be furious at me. And so you have to do full stop in the wow practice. Otherwise, it's going to be too much. The rocking of the boat is too much. So, but for me, it's okay. I did another 165 graphics this morning. So that's 365 in the last 24 hours, basically, or less. And that sort of calmed me down, sort of grounded me, ate some food, and took a rest, you know, and just full stop on the wow, not get ahead of myself. And so it's sort of built in all this practice. I'm able to get the boat of belief rocked very severely without panicking. But the panic—it's always possible to certainly panic if you don't, if you're not very confident in practicing full stop on the wow and being also very humble enough to realize that there's only so much rocking of the boat you can handle at any one time. See, it's humility is required too. The overconfident take a fall at some point. They get stuck is the point. The overconfident, they get stuck. They may go really high, but they can't go any further, and they get stuck, and then they just try to overcompensate for that stuckness by all sorts of erudition and stuff like that. And you can tell if someone's stuck. So you have to be humble enough to say, wow, I've gone really far, but you know, my boat's, I'm really shaken with the continuity issue right here. Let me just sit down for a while and take it easy let this continuity fear dissipate. So stay humble. Stay humble. Mood of repentance. Very humble. Severely modest, very humble. That doesn't mean you don't make proclamations. You do, but you still have an attitude of humility, realizing that, you know, I'm still subject to this continuity fear. There's no question about it. So you might come across someone who's very far along, but you wouldn't hardly know it at all unless they say something. But they might just be, you know, very, very nondescript, anonymous, self-effacing, humble. They might say a few things that lurch you to the fact that they may know what's going on, but they realize that, you know, that they're struggling with their next step, all right? They're struggling with their next step. So everyone on the path is struggling, should be struggling with their next step, and we don't want to have this high and mighty attitude. The tone. It doesn't mean we can't be confident at times and take the next step and flip the script. Sure, when we're flipping the script, but once we flip the script, then it's back to full stop and the wow, and then we go to assertions if we can. So we're always struggling with the next step until we actually are truly liberated. But even then, we're struggling to get used to that. So for most. Most of us, almost all of us, we're struggling with the next step. And this is the attitude that's required. It's attitude of saying, hey, I'm looking to see, you know, what is the next step? Okay, how can I... And it may be very baffling. So you're praying to the Holy Spirit. You're asking for clarification. You're using discipline, full stop, and the wow. You know, using all of the tools so that next step can be taken. So for me now, I have to somehow take the next step, which is to, you know, to go even bigger. And I don't know exactly what that's going to be, because yesterday we went so big. The wow is still reverberating. But you cannot just rest on your wows, and that you have to keep going big. So this is my focus. I'm trying to look now, what's the next step? And as you go along, step by step by step, you'll notice that there are those who have, you know, kind of set up shop along the path. For some reason, they didn't want to go any further, and they'll lecture you, they'll tell you what they think about you, and you get various feedback from all sorts of people, and you know, and it's like you just have to keep on going. You just have to keep on going. Everybody's in the same boat. I've put up with this my whole life, actually. Every step of the way, there are pundits who want to for you to sit and listen to them, and they're going to set you right. Like, this is the place to stop, basically, or listen to them. I mean, that just gives them something, some excuse, right, not to go any further. Somebody's listening to them. And so what we're getting at here is the tools of the path. So that you can keep going. You can keep going. It's full stop in the wow. It's a practice we have here that enables you to keep going and keep going and keep going, even though you're going to get pundits for sure. Again, I've had thousands upon thousands upon thousands of pundits tell me that I needed to stop. That was enough, and listen to them. It's just a never-ending stream. You always are going to have that, it seems like, just about always. And you just have to say thank you for going so far. But, you know, I just have to, you know, I don't feel like I'm there yet. So I have to keep on keeping on here. And they stop. Why? Because they think at some point the taboo kicks in, like, wow, I better not say another word. I better not go any further, because the god of guilt's going to really judge me, or, you know, it's taboo. It's taboo. Can't go any further. This is taboo. This is the end of the road. And so it's tough when they tell you that this is it. They didn't go any further, not because they weren't smart, but because it was taboo. You can't do it. Can't do it. Can't go any further. And you say, well, you know, it's for me. I see I can. And so I just have to get my nerve up to do it. This is the way. This is the struggle here. And the struggle here in this world is really almost beggars description, how difficult it is. Everybody trying to pretend to be dead, trying to look for authentic death. And they'll say, wow, you just go far enough on the path and then you die and that's authentic death. And of course, what the whole point of the path is to realize there's no such thing as authentic death. It's impossible. Not to think that by going really, really far and then dying, that's what you'll find it then. Not true. Not true. So what's important is to get used to using the tools of the path that bring you along the path. That is what's important. That's the overriding importance. That's why I keep stressing full stop in the wow. Full stop in neutral mode. You know, neither going forward nor back. Neither yes nor no. Just in a maybe thing. I'm both responding and not responding. I'm both responding and not responding. And this is a tool to instead of getting frozen and paralyzed, and then you listen to a pundit say, you got to stop here. You take a break and you just say, okay, I need a little break here. So, yeah, I'm both listening and not listening. When the pundit says, you're not listening, say, well, yeah, I'm both listening and not listening. Or I'm both not listening and listening. So, you know, right away, a huge deep breath occurred from that. And the pressure suddenly seemed to drop away. Pressure of fear, like, oh, wow, and maybe I need to listen to a pundit now. Yes, I'm both not listening, as the pundit's saying, you're not listening. I'm both not listening and listening. Both. Oh. So that takes the edge of the pressure off, right? Because you did say, yeah, I am listening. I'm both listening and not listening. So this weakens the ego, very badly weakens the ego. You can't really get any momentum going when you take this position. So this is a super, super important technique that you need to use. We all need to use this. The maybe, I'm both listening and not listening. Yes, I'm both listening and not listening. Of course, this is used after you've already made a big push of flipping the script and assertions, and now you're in the wow. Okay, it's not a stance to use all the time, because then you won't get around to flipping the script and making assertions. But once the wow arises, then, oh, you say, wow, I just need to settle down a little bit. This is pretty shaky here. So, yes, I'm both listening and not listening. I'm both moving and not moving. I'm both resting and not resting. And so you refuse to characterize it, because once you characterize it, then the ego can oppose your characterization, or at least engage you relative to your position, relative to your characterization. You see, and so if you say, I'm moving, and then the ego say, well, let me tell you why it's important not to move. And you say, I'm not moving, the ego say, let me tell you why it's important to move. So the ego, you know, in the guise of the pundit, no matter how you characterize it, it will play off of that, you know. It will. It say, oh, I'm listening. And the ego say, well, you know what? You know, listening shouldn't be a good thing. Let me explain to you, blah, blah, blah. And you say, well, I'm not listening. Oh, you know, not listening is not a good thing. Let me explain to you why. So no matter how you characterize your situation, the ego is going to then leap on that like a famished tiger. or leopard, you know, just, and we'll engage on that. So what you say, hey ego, I'm both listening and not listening. Yeah, I'm both listening and not listening. And then the ego will try to say, well, what do I do about this characterization? You can't be wishy-washy. I'm not being wishy-washy. I'm both being wishy-washy and not being wishy-washy. You see, don't allow yourself to get pulled into a polarized characterization where the ego then can take the opposing viewpoint and then start arguing and start chipping away at you, because that's what it'll do. That's what it will do. So getting to this clarification I've gotten to so far, it requires very skillful use of these means of the practice we have. Assertions, full stop and the wow, flipping the script. That wonderful practice, and then the maybe practice, a both practice. I'm both doing this and that. So no characterization practice, right? And now in the assertions, we have various forms of assertions, we know that. But in the full stop and the wow, where you're shaky, you do not want to allow the ego to push you into a corner of characterization. Stay out of the corner of characterization. Do not get cornered. And the ego may pretend to be all non-dual also and say, oh yeah, okay, this is great in certain circumstances, but even that isn't it. And I say, well, listen, you know, and it'll try to, and you say, well, I'm both listening and not listening to you. Yeah, I'm listening, I'm both listening to you and not listening to you. I'm both responding to what you're saying and not responding. I'm both hearing what you're saying and not hearing what you're saying. You see, so you do not allow yourself to be cornered. This is where people get stuck. This is where we get stuck on the path. You can get very far along, but at some point, you know, you end up getting stuck because the ego has pushed you into a corner, is what's happened. It's cornered you. Okay. And then you're fending off, you know, you feel like you get defensive. You don't want to get defensive with the ego. And this is even for those who are very advanced. This still applies. This truism applies. Do not allow yourself to get cornered by the ego in any sort of characterization where it can push you into a corner. So now when the wow calms down, then you can push the ego around a lot better. You just say, get out of my way. I'm going forward. But there's a vulnerable time in the wow. There's a vulnerable time. Now, some of us have actually gone very far and then didn't realize the wow. We thought, hey, maybe I can just force things. And the wow became so strong, it became a complex in us, and we didn't recognize it. And from that complex, we then took a position. We tried to characterize our situation and feel stable. As soon as we did that, then the ego has got us. It's got us by the throat. And then, so we've gotten pushed into like this corner, and then we're trying to, you know, from that corner, be a pundit about being in a corner. And this is what happens to the best of us, actually. So, even if you're the best, almost the best, so to speak, almost the best, this is a real possibility that it happens. And I have to guard against this, of course. Everybody does. Our resistance is ferocious. So, always check in for the wow. And if you're not flipping the script or you're not doing assertions, then I say you must be in the wow. Or, of course, you have, you know, but we don't need to say, if you're enlightened, you know you're enlightened, and you will tell the world that you are. You'll make it very clear. You'll just say, yes, I am enlightened. I have finished. So if you're not explicitly saying to the world, confessing that I have indeed, I am indeed abiding in the vision of oneness. You know, make your confession however you want to make it. If then, and you're not, then it means you haven't finished. And then, so you're either flipping the script, or you're doing assertions, or you're in the wow. And if you don't realize you're in the wow, that means that's where you're stuck. You're stuck. So getting unstuck is the answer. Now, I a lot of times I've been stuck, and then I just ask myself, Am I in the wow? Is this some severe wow? And then I'll suddenly recognize, oh my gosh, it is. And then I'll just say, oh, full stop in the wow. I'm neither this nor that. Just a maybe. Let me go back in neutral. And then I center, get centered. And before you know it, the complex is just, phew, evaporated, and suddenly I'm going ahead again. So this is a truism. It's very easy to listen to teachers who do not emphasize this and get stuck in the wow. And they may want you to be stuck in the wow, because then you're aggrandizing them, like you know, you're dependent on them, so to speak. You become very dependent on the teacher. And maybe the teacher is stuck also in some very aggrandized complex of wow, where they become a super pundit. And then they need this, they need an audience. That's very possible. I mean, I know it's happened over and over and over and over again. And, you know, this is something that has to be guarded against to an extraordinary extent. Not that you shouldn't listen to anyone, but at the center is your practice. You see? What's that? That's the phone. It's going off. It's your practice. I don't know why the phone it just went back on. That's really weird. It wasn't even off. It's your practice that's important. You're the one doing the practice, right? We all are the ones doing the practice. So you have to be aware of your own wow. And the teacher should be pointing it out to, hey, you know, we did this very intense, but you know, the wow is there. It's going to be there. The boat is rocked. If you do any such spiritual effort, if you put your really intent into it and it's working for you, the whole idea is to get to the wow. So you should absolutely, that should be your default position in any spiritual practice, is for sure the wow is going to be there, and I have to account for it. I have to do this full stop. I have to go neutral mode. I have to make sure I'm not being cornered. Okay, this should be the primary teaching, no matter what teacher or pundit you're listening to or paying attention to. Always this should be, you should be aware of your own path. Otherwise, you're going to end up getting stuck and going into some reaction formation to that. And there's lots of different reaction formations people could go into. And so some teachers are just producing these reaction formations, which then dump that problem on to other teachers. And you just run into people all over the place that you know, have obviously made a lot of progress spiritually, but then are stuck. And then that's your problem now, that you have to try to deal with it, you know? So it's there needs to be a much greater awareness of this full stop and the wow. That there is a three-part practice, actually. A spiritual path is these three aspects that as you're going forward, you're either flipping the script in some way, which is getting a new perspective, working and getting a new perspective, or you're asserting, you know, you're making assertions, you're making, call it affirmations, you're making prayers, you're making focus of, I know that I've already done this, I know that I'm already true, I know truth is already true, and stuff like that. Or you're in the wow, mode. Okay. I don't know if I'm gonna. So this has to be at the very center. Whatever you're doing, be aware, where am I at in my practicing? Because you're practicing 24 hours a day, basically. I'd like to be able to be aware of this when I'm sleeping. You know, catch this when I'm sleeping. Say, hey, wait a minute. You know, where am I in my spiritual practice mode? And I hopefully it can spill over into my sleeping time also, which would be a massive benefit, of course. Now, don't think that we can just ignore the wow and say, well, that means that maybe I'm just there. So try to, you know, power through and say, let me just try and see if I can just finish now. No, keep full stopping in the wow, and trust that truth will automatically arise. The clarity will automatically arise when you're ready. It's not something that can be forced or that needs to be forced at all. It will automatically happen for you. You just have to keep discipline. I know it's difficult because you think every day I've got to be disciplined. No, that's true. Every day we have to be disciplined. Otherwise, we're going to get stuck. And really, characteristically, everyone you see in the world is stuck. Almost everyone is stuck somewhere. They're stuck. They're fixated. They're stuck. And so to get spiritual progress at all, we have to have a technique to get unstuck and to keep from getting stuck so frequently. So this is why there are basics that are, and the basics are all important, actually. The basic tools, it's all important. It's like piano. You don't teach someone that you play the lower register with your right arm and the upper register with your left arm, and this is the normal way to play, you know? You say, no, you use the left hand for the lower register and the right hand for the register, and sometimes you cross over, okay, like that, but the basics is, you know, like this. And you don't play with your back turned to the piano, you know, with your arms stretched behind you, you know, you don't do that. And you keep your hands like this, you don't turn them upside down and try to play with the bottoms of your fingers, you know. I mean, these are basic, you know, very basics that we think, oh, of course. But on the spiritual path, there's these basics, and if we get them wrong, then we're absolutely hamstrung and going to get stuck. And I don't see any emphasis on the basics, hardly any emphasis at all in the world. It's all about, oh, I had a peak experience, and then talking about it or something. What is that? That's a terrible example. I mean, the talking should be done still in the context of right practice. Everything should be done in the context of right practice. And this is just not happening at all here. So that's why I say this you know, this technocracy is going nowhere fast. So it's a waste of time to try and teach anyone if they're not interested in the basics and applying themselves, because they're going to get stuck, severely stuck, and then there's going to be all sorts of conflict, and they'll lecture you and tell you how wrong you are, and how you need to stop and listen to them, and this kind of stuff. It doesn't go anywhere. So if I'm irritated with Jesus, for instance, I say, well, I got a wow problem. I'm not acknowledging that I'm still reverberating with some, you know, I need to focus in, center in, spend some quiet time, be humble, and just go into this neutral mode, not judging for or against truth. Or you can say both. I'm both judging for truth and not for truth. You know, however you want to do it, to not get backed into a corner. Because the ego is there like a wild animal, ready to pounce on you, like it's your it's meat. It's like your dinner. But it just wants to fixate on you. But if you stay in this neutral mode, it can't fixate on you. So it's waiting to pounce, and you just have to keep in this neutral mode. So it's way more important to introduce this sort of teaching than it is to try and, you know, anything else. Way more important. Because you're not going to get to where you want to get to, or imagining that your eternal life, actually, if you don't have these tools. You're going to get fixated. And so there's no success. You look at the world, what do I see? No success. Terrible lack of success here. And this is because the basics have not been taught properly, and everybody's trying to pretend they're more advanced than they are. They say, oh, I don't need the basics, you know, I'm a pundit. You know, well, a pundit is somebody who should be expert at the basics. Okay, what true pundit is not expert at the basics? There is none. There is none. You know, it's like, what true virtuoso isn't, you know, flawless at the basics, right? You don't become a virtuoso unless you absolutely, the basics are absolutely ingrained within you, and you know how to apply everything, you know, all the basics, you know exactly, you know, how to apply them, when to apply them, how to stay centered in everything. You're not a true virtuoso. You might become a showman or something. You can be that, but not a virtuoso. And, you know, people are enthralled by showmanship. But you can tell the difference between someone who's just a showman and a true virtuoso. You can tell the difference for sure. And it's way better to listen to a virtuoso. Showman is just, it's just cheap carnival, carny stuff, you know, sideshow. Clowns and jesters and stuff that, but they can do all sorts of flourishes and embellishments and wow, you know, look at this, fireworks, you know, but when it comes to tackling some really beautiful, intrinsic, you know, beautifully intricate and delivering, you know, a virtuoso performer, they can't do it. They cannot do it. And so they want to say, well, nobody else can do it either, you know. So they want to stay, you know, in the center stage because they say, well, nobody can do it. So why do you, there's no, you don't have options. There are no options. Well, there are virtuosos. And so this is where we're called to that. We're called to shift pretending that we're dead to pretending that we're eternal life. And we're called to that. So, again, there's no true pundit, no true guru, no true sage who isn't, you know, extraordinarily, wonderfully grounded in the basics, the basic tools of the path. And they will tell you, you have to be also. Now, we're all in such a hurry. We don't want to be showmen. We want to impress that significant other, that special relationship, you know. We want to say, wow, you see how easy it is for me? I'm extraordinary. I'm special. I don't even need the basics. I can do all this fancy stuff, but it doesn't work. Not when we're dealing with the continuity fear that we're dealing with. We have to be very grounded in right spiritual practice. So sure, the some of the spiritual rhetoric is wonderful, but never should you allow it to unground you from the basics, right, spiritual practice. So whatever the content is that you're listening to, make sure you still you have to be grounded in right spiritual practice. No matter how elevated it may seem, you're still going to have a wow reaction. You still need to assert the truth, and you still need to flip the script and get your perspective in alignment. So all the tools, and you still need to make sure you don't get backed into a corner by the ego, which is the trickiest thing of all. Anybody can listen, can read some very lofty, you know, spiritual writings, but you know what happens later? Well, the ego's got them pinned into a corner. And then now they're all defensive, all frustrated, and trying to get out of the corner through all sorts of showmanship and self-aggrandizement. It doesn't work. So you have to, you know, first it's both. Yeah, I'm both listening and not listening, both responding and not responding, both understanding and not understanding. And once you then relax and get that, then you can start pushing back at the ego and say, hey, you got a problem with me? Great. I'm the perfect problem. Yeah, I am. I already am the perfect problem. I know I already am the perfect problem. Absolutely, I am. You know, and you start asserting the negative like that, you see, which is very disarming for the ego. Because it basically tries to back you in a corner by getting you to assert the positive, you know. But when you assert the negative and use the perfect, say, I am that perfect negative. I am the perfect fool. I am the perfect failure. I am the perfect failure. You know, the ego is like, oh, I don't know what to, you know, it just... It disarms the ego. It takes all the wind out of its sails. Because, you know, it's trying to make you a perfect failure. You say, I already am the perfect failure. I failed to do the impossible. Of course, the ego's trying to get you to fail to be the perfect death, you know, the authentic death. And you say, I'm already the perfect failure. And the ego says, well, you need to succeed. Ah, it's too late. I'm already the perfect failure. The ego says, you need to succeed and die and having an authentic death. I say, well, I'm already the perfect failure. I'm already the perfect failure. So can't help but fail at that. Too late. So what these videos do is again and again and again, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of times, focus on the basics, the actual practicing the basics. It's like building a house, you have tools. Spiritual path, you need tools. Otherwise, the ego is just going to absolutely clobber you. And This is wisdom won from a lifetime of effort and getting clobbered by the ego over and over and over and over. I kept thinking, well, I don't need to really, you know, pay attention to that. But then, you know, you're backed into a corner and your mind is racing this way and that way. And, you know, the ego's got you where it wants you. It wants your mind to be racing. It wants your mind to be thinking. Instead, you say, well, yeah, I'm both thinking about it and not thinking about it. See? The ego says, what do you think about everything I've been saying? Well, ego, I've been thinking about it, and I'm both thinking about what you said and not thinking about what you said. Okay? And just leave it just like that. Thinking about what you said and not thinking about it. Well, ego, I'm both thinking and not thinking. Well, the ego say, well, you need to relax. Well, yeah, ego, I'm both relaxing and not relaxing. And the ego say, well, I want you to relax. Well, I am both relaxing and not relaxing. Well, that'd be better for you. Just relax. Well, sure, I'm both doing what's better for me and what's not better for me. And the ego will say, well, you're crazy. Yeah, I'm both crazy and not crazy. I'm being both crazy and not crazy. Again, the ego say, well, that's just, you're just being crazy. Yeah, well, I'm both being crazy and not being crazy. Well, which one is it? Well, it's both. Well, I'm being both and not both. You try that one. Yes, I'm both being both and not both. See, the ego thought it had me there. Well, yes, ego. I'm both being both and not both. So obviously, these videos are like therapy for those who are, you know, you might say that they're quite advanced in the difficulties of that, because without the right technique like this, the ego is going to slow you down too much and then tell you to overcompensate for that. Now, I can hardly say that I've been slowed down, you know, too much, having gotten to a complete new perspective of Jesus, how he simply was accommodating the continuity fear in part of the drama. He allowed certain drama to take place as a mere accommodation. That's it. You know, this is beyond even docetism. This is a clearer explanation than I've ever come across. I've hardly been fixated or slowed down. And so this is an example of the success of these techniques that I'm talking about, and you know, enabled this tremendous breakthrough to happen. Enabled me to recognize Jesus has come back, and that he's not making the same accommodations as before. That's why people are not missing him. They expect, you know, we try to get tricky, and we say, well, I become bargainers. Well, I want more accommodation. Let's bargain on this bargain. Instead of just accepting, well, whatever accommodation he's going to give, that's going to be right. So let me not worry about it. Let me just keep working here. But he's not making accommodations this time, really. Just says, I've come back to relate as a friend. See, this is much closer, you know, it's right on the level. Whereas before, he said, well, you want to see me as a king and this and that, and you want me to tell the spirit has to die and be resurrected, etc. Okay, I'll accommodate your script to a certain point, certain amount of accommodation for your script, If you, then give some listen to what I have to say. So that's what he did. He accommodated our script to a certain point. Now he's not so accommodating of our script, because we need to drop the script. So if we just keep thinking that, well, Jesus is always going to be so accommodating, we're missing the boat. It's not true at all. We're being pushed to make real genuine progress here. And so again, you know, everybody has the struggle with the next step every day. I'm no different right now. I'm struggling. Okay, but that doesn't mean that I haven't made huge progress. I have, but still, then there's the struggle for the next big step. But going first and making these declarations is most definitely a sign of progress, great progress. Because it's very difficult to go first, as I've said before. And also still quite difficult to follow along with that, to hear it and follow along. Absolutely. A lot of fear there, a lot of taboo fear. Very mild weather now in California. Just beautiful. 86 to 88. Soft, cool breeze. Just, we're enjoying it while it lasts. There's supposed to be some horrendous El Nino this year, so it could be the worst ever. You know, they're trying to be alarmist as always. Hottest ocean temperature, strongest El Nino, floods. They're warning us that it could be terrible floods this year. You know, once a 100-year floods this year. Well. You know, they love. What else are weather people going to do, except, you know, talk about what might happen as far as the weather goes? You know, they're going to say, "Well, we don't really know." Well, okay, let me know when you know. But instead, "Oh, we think there might be terrible floods coming up." Okay. But the readings are there. So what they're saying is, look, this is a potentiality here, which is true. There is a potential for severe flooding, absolutely. Will it happen that way? Yeah. Well, at this point, we're, you know, you could say I'm not sure, but probably you should make preparations. So I'd say that's valid. We should make preparations, because there is a potential for inundation, and as we know, the weather around the world is becoming more extreme. So there's certainly a possibility of inundation. I mean, Australia got inundated several years back. The terrible flooding in Australia. They'd had a long drought there, and then the country just got turned into a swamp. It was just extraordinary. I mean, there's a big lake. I mean, there was like some huge lake that was not even never the number there before. And it was just like a big lake. I mean, this is what happened. So, I mean, it is certainly possible that, of course, the Pacific Northwest is just getting hammered by another severe record-breaking heat wave. I mean, this is unprecedented for the Pacific Northwest. It's usually very cool, rainy, cool, and they're just getting extraordinary heat waves. So the weather patterns are certainly shifting. And of course, the Far East, I think Iran, Iraq, and that area, they're getting hammered with, what do they say, the Weather Channel is the most tabloid site on the whole internet, most alarmist, most extremist. You know, they always have some headlines screaming, "This could happen." Anyway, they say the relative heat index was like 166 or something. You know, it feels like 166. The actual temperature is like 122 or something, but how they get 166 out of that, I am not sure. That's pretty funny. That's their headline. Heat hits 166. Heat index. It's 166 in Iran. You know, that's hot. So hot that they gave everybody 4 days off. Just stay cool. You know, stay out of the heat. Which is a sensible thing to do. They didn't do that in India. Yeah, they should have. You got construction workers dropping like flies. So how do we go big? You know, how do we keep going big every day? This is a discipline everyone should have wherever they're at. From there, what they're used to, each one of us needs to go really big every day. Now, of course, if everyone is in a slightly different place on the path, so what seems big to them may not seem big to someone else. Or what seems like going big for me might, for someone else, like might seem like, wow, it's way too much. It's going crazy. It's extreme. But just it depends where you're at. To go 365 graphics, every one of them just breathtakingly beautiful. You know, some might think like doing 10 of those is like going really, really huge. And it would be. I mean, just for me, just doing like a 100 of them or so before, just blew my mind. I couldn't take it. I mean, that was just a very severe wow. But now I'm much more used to it. So doing 365, you know, didn't burn me out. There's a couple that hit me pretty hard, but I've gotten used to it already. So it, you know, just go. But the basic truism stands: go big every day. Wherever you're at, what's big for you, say, today, I fundamentally went further today. You know, in a fundamental way, I went further today than yesterday. Now, I really feel like I'm much farther along today. I went really big. So this needs to be a motto, too. Mottos help a lot on the path. It's a simple motto. Oh, yeah, go big. You know, just remind yourself, oh, I need to go big today. Little reminders that are not complicated. It's very difficult to call to mind like sometimes assertions, you know, that are, yes, I already know that I'm already free and I'm already, but if you just say, go big, I need to go big. Easy reminder, hey, wait a minute, what am I doing today? I need to go big. Okay, so that's what I'm doing. You're sitting there at your computer and saying, wait a minute, what am I doing? I need to go big today. And then this just then brings your focus, say, okay, you ask the Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, help me go big today. And I said, I have to go big today somehow. I don't know how. But Holy Spirit's going to make it happen. Just have this belief that go big wherever you are, even if you're, you know, like super, super, super. Still say, I need to go big today. What's the next step? Let me go even bigger than I've gone before. When you get stuck, then the ego gets you into defensive mode. You see, this is the problem. You're cornered, and the ego, by getting you cornered, puts you on the defensive. And this shows up in your mind. This shows up in the way you're dealing with everything. You're in a defensive posture. And that never works. You need to be in an expansive state of mind. Like, hey, I'm not cornered. I do have the option to go big right now, and I'm going to do it. So the wow puts you in the just is, I'm taking a little break. Okay. Then once the wow wears off, then you feel expansive again. So you want to keep feeling expansive and not defensive. So we've been going extremely fast here. But at the same time, emphasizing the basics, which everyone can use and everyone needs to use, actually. You cannot take the path without some know-how and some tools, the right tools, to avoid the ego, you know, pinning you into a corner. And if you're going to take the path successfully, the wows are going to arise continuously, because you're going to say, wow, I'd made so much progress. Wow, I'm not as trapped as I thought I was. Wow. And so you have to be able to deal with this wow. Have to be able to deal with it. So just tell the Holy Spirit that you're insisting you have to go out big today. Got to go big. It's the apocalypse. You know, to surf the apocalypse, you have to go big every day. You cannot get into the habit of going small, because then you'll start sinking down, and the turbulence of the apocalypse will sweep you along like a tsunami. You must stay buoyant. And in order to do that, you have to be expansive. And in order to do that, you can't be pushed into a corner by the ego. Okay. Now, if you're enlightened, I would say, from the glimpses I've got and the times I've been into abiding in it for a little bit, is you say, well, how can I help others then? And then you end up coming out of it thinking that, I'm not sure. But what you can do is just to suggest to them, just say, well, I'm both enlightened and not enlightened. When the ego tries to pin you into a corner, just say that. Well, are you enlightened? So at the level of words, it's important to not get pinned down. And some teachers actually teach this way, where they say, well, I'm both this and not this. And I'm both and not both. What they're saying is suggesting to you, use this terminology when the ego is trying to pin you into a conceptual framework, you see. And so you might say, well, I'm both, my framework is both flattened and not flattened. Now, when you're addressing the ego, when you're addressing yourself, you don't need to address yourself conceptually. You're feeling, you're aware of it. But conceptually, as soon as you start speaking conceptually with words, then the ego is going to go after you. And so you can say, well, I'm both enlightened and not enlightened. Or I'm both and neither. Because what you're saying is you're beyond concepts. So you don't need concepts. So this is the context in which pundits, real pundits, are speaking. That they're beyond, the state is beyond any need for concepts. No need for an authentic death. So whatever you say about it, it's not really it. And from a practical standpoint, in using concepts, then you want to then take refuge in this both and neither. I'm both doing this and that. And then the ego tries to trap you there. You say, I'm doing both and neither. Neither am I doing neither nor both. Well, then what are you doing? Well, I'm doing both and not both. So this is just a technique. We're not suggesting that this is something you need to conceptually crunch the numbers down. No, it's a technique to cause the ego, to paralyze the ego, so to speak. It's to keep from being put on the defensive. So you can remain in your expansiveness. The expansive presence remains. Because what happens, if you're in the expansive presence of enlightenment, non-dual, pretending you're eternal life, others will want to, you know, ask questions. They want to, others, others' egos will get concerned, like, whoa, you know, this doesn't seem like authentic death. We need authentic death here. What are you doing? And then they'll ask questions, and they'll try to pin you, you know, into a corner. So then the ego can then throw you into a defensive position, which it feels is the way to authentic death. You know, contracted state, defensive contracted state, you're in a corner. Whereas the presence of expansive presence of pretending to be eternal life, this helps us here, like, oh, I feel this is, reminds me of truth, of my true home, my true life. Wow. I want to give up trying to find an authentic death. And the ego will then fight against that and try to knock out the expansiveness. The feeling of expansiveness is what the ego is really after. The ego doesn't really care what words you're using. The ego will engage you and use all sorts of words, whatever, like spiritual, non-spiritual, whatever. The ego doesn't care. It only is after you to contract and shrink into a cornered, defensive vibration. That's all that it cares about. So it might praise you, it might attack you, it might do this. Well, however it can get you to start characterizing and then cornering you, this is what it will do. It doesn't really know what you're talking about anyway. The ego is completely stupid that way. It doesn't really know what you're talking about. But it is very, very shrewd in trying to get you in a contracted state, in a defensive posture. This it knows. So really, don't engage with ego with words. I mean, whatever, you can use these contradictory seeming words, because the ego doesn't even care what you're saying anyway. It just wants to frighten you and contract you and put you in a defensive posture. But it might pretend like, well, you said this, now wait a minute, all this legalism, now wait a minute, you said that, and this contradiction. The ego doesn't care. It's just trying to get you to be defensive. If you ask the ego, well, what's your position? What did I say? I don't know. I don't remember. So, this is the key. So we could say from the enlightened, well, from the standpoint of the ego, I'm both enlightened and not enlightened. And both enlightened and not enlightened, and neither enlightened or not enlightened. And on and on and on, ad absurdum. Don't get too aggressive on the path, full stop in the wow. Remember, you make progress, then check in and see how strong the wow is and how pinned down you are by that. Giants game today. Giants had a great chance. Ninth inning, bases loaded, 2-0 count. They're behind 2-1. I mean, it was all set up, and I said, don't be too aggressive on this 2-0 pitch. Make the pitcher throw a strike. If it's low, let it go. If it's low, because they're trying to get a double play ground ball. So if it's low, just let it go. What's the worst that can happen? 2-1, you're still in the driver's seat. Well, the hitter swung at the 2-0 pitch. It was a sinker low, ground into a double play, end of the game. See, that's the last thing you needed to do. Make the pitcher get the ball up on 2-0. If it's low, just let it go. You know, that should be something in everyone's mind. It's 2-0, like in a situation like that. If it's low, let it go. But over-anxious to be a hero loses the game. So, on the path, you know, you cannot be over-anxious to finish at the expense of checking in with the wow. How bad was I rocked my boat so severely. How do I feel? Am I still shaky? Of course, if you're in the water and your boat's rocking, you're gonna be a little jittery about it, for sure. And no matter how good your sea legs are, if there's some horrendous storm, I mean, even the most hardened sea captains and seamen, if there's some terrible storm, if they make it home alive, you know, they're like, you know, they're shaken by it. Don't let them tell you otherwise. And by the way, I spoke in the other video about animals and protecting animals. That's great. Fine. I say people are going very fanatic. That's not so great. They're going over the. They're losing their common sense. But you know, the idea of hunting, they say, oh, it's so terrible. Well, for me, I don't like hunting fish. I wonder what, I don't understand why these animal rights people don't take up the role of fish. I mean, I saw someone caught this huge marlin in Hawaii, I think. Gigantic marlin. Oh my gosh. I mean, why? Why, you see? Is not that marlin just as majestic an animal as a lion? I say it is. For me, I look at marine life. I mean, the first life in this world, I mean, is based a lot of it marine life. The marine life has been around a lot longer than animal life. And you get some of these fish are hundreds of years old. And you know, I see marine animals as having personalities, actually. When I look at a fish's face, one of these big fish been around a long time, you can just see the personality. I can see this has consciousness. This has personality. You know, so I feel just as bad if somebody pulls a, you know, a real old, like a lobster. They pulled some lobster. It must have been, what, 130 or, back east in gigantic lobster. It weighed, what, 30 pounds. And this lobster had been around over 100 years, maybe 150, just a long, long time. And the one that had it finally said, you know what? I'm just not going to cook this lobster. I can't. Let's give respect to this lobster. And they put it in a museum where it gets to live. So I said, yeah, you know, that's really great. That's really great. So sea creatures have, for me, they need to be respected too. Now we say, well, we use them for food. Well, we also use land creatures for food, right? I use, you know, a lot of land creatures. So, you know, I understand, you know, endangered species. Well, there are a lot of fish that are endangered species too. So I think there's a double standard there. There really is. If you go to an aquarium, if you've gone to some really nice aquariums, you're looking at these big fish, and they come there and looking at you, and you look them in the eye, you know, you feel like you're not looking at something that's stupid, something that's just a robot or machine or something. This fish has said, hey, I've been around, and I've experienced a lot. You know, I've been through a lot of battles and a lot of scary stuff, and I've been through a lot of happiness. I've been through, you know, I've lived like this life, you know, and it shows on my countenance, and it shows in my vibration, and I say hello, fish, how are you doing? And because I feel like, you know, it's similar to land animals. You see, if I see a bird, I'll say hello to the bird, and, you know, hey bird, how you doing today? And greet it. And of course they might look at me and say, yeah, hi, but I'm busy, you know. So of course the people are protecting the whales, that's good, trying to keep them going from extinct. And so certain mammalian creatures are being protected, the sea otters, the sea lions, and, you know, so. But how about just the fish? I mean, I feel the same way to a fish that would, was a dog or a cat or any other creature. I mean, some of these fish, you think, wow. You know, it's not a dolphin. I mean, they protect the dolphins. They're mammals. But are these fish really nothing? I don't think so. I hate to see these big fish, trophy fish caught. I admire these fish. This bass, they pull some bass out that's, you know, 35 pounds or something. Just is really, really old, 80 years old or something. And it's not easy living 80 years old anywhere here, is it? So for me, respect, catch and release, you know, catch and release the big fish. We're protecting sharks now, right? Anyway, it's interesting. I just want to stand up for fish, marine animals, of all types, marine animals. The you know, just the life that goes on underneath the ocean is extraordinary. I mean, it puts us to shame, the life that's gone on land and the life under the water. There's so much going on. It's just mind-blowing, the complexity and diversity under the water. And that's been going on for hundreds and hundreds and hundreds, maybe billions of years, really, you know, billions. How long have sharks been around? And the fish, they're smart. I mean, they migrate. They do all sorts of stuff. They've got a life. They have a life. They're not just there for us to eat. They have a life. All marine creatures have lives. Of course, they're struggling to survive. Which isn't easy in the ocean, is it? Everyone's a predator. There's so many predators there. Everything is a predator in the ocean, it seems like. My gosh. It's a fish-eat-fish world there. That's to say the least. And we're just giving a little time to settle down, which we do. We have to settle down. Because the wow is going to, it's got a bite to it. That is for sure. Okay. So, as usual, I make the admonitions and explain, and the world will ignore it or forget it. But you can't afford to forget. So what's the first easiest thing to remember? Go big. I got to go big today. What's the next step? Wow. How about where's my wow? You know, where's my wow at? Where's my wow at right now? So go big, where's my wow at? I gotta check in on the wow, see how strong it is right now. I'm always on the path, one of three phases. I'm always in one of three phases. Now, we can get stuck in the wow. We don't want to get stuck. We want to do a full stop where we're in control. We're using the technique neutral. I'm neither stopped nor not stopped. I'm neither advancing nor retreating. So we have to preempt the wow. It's the glass half full. So this is it maintains your expansiveness. Say, I'm being more expansive, but I'm kind of I feel like, oh wow, that's enough for now. Okay, maintain the glass half full stance. So is my glass half full? Do I feel half full? Where's my wow at? Go big. These are techniques that you have to remember during the day. It's mandatory that you keep your attention, pulling your attention back to where am I at on the path. Otherwise, we're going to get fixated and stuck. And then you just take that as, well, this is just normal life. Everybody's fixated and stuck, right? Aren't you? You're fixated and stuck? Yeah. You are too? Sure. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, nobody expansive here. We're all striving for our authentic death. Yes. Okay, good. Great. I'm right on track then. You know, this is the world. Oh, I'm watching a hard liquor commercial. Oh, it looks like people having fun there. They look kind of expansive because they're all wasted, you know. And maybe I need to do that. If I need to feel expansive, that's how I'm going to go about it, you know. And before you know it, you got an addiction to alcohol or something. It is just like that. You just look at the world and the addictions that people get into. It's because they're stuck, plain and simple. Anyone can get out of addiction if they just recognize the wow and start being serious about effectively dealing with wow by using these techniques that we're sharing here. Any addiction will you can get out of it, because an addiction is just the ego's got you cornered, is all. And then you're trying to be expansive even while you're cornered, which is you can't really. So then you turn to, you know, sex, drugs, rock and roll, we call it the SDR. You think, oh, I'm hammered, you know. I'm around a bunch of other people that are hammered, and we're all pawing each other, and we're look how expansive we're being. And of course, that is not true expansiveness at all. You're just pretending to be dead. It's like, look how authentically dead I am. Even when I try to be expansive, it's still not true expansiveness. More proof that I'm authentically dead. And no, we can't be gratefully, authentically dead either. Oh, I'm so grateful I'm authentically dead. You know, I'm one of the grateful dead. No. I know that's not the original meaning of it. But you get the gist of it, actually. So you can't use gratitude and say, well, I'm so grateful that I'm dead. That makes it authentic. My gratitude for my death makes it authentic death. certified. We even got a tombstone. I'm in the ground. I am certifiably dead. And now I'm just waiting for the resurrection. That's the next step, right? Just, once you're authentically dead, then you wait. Just you're in limbo. You're waiting for a purgatory. You go to limbo. Waiting for the resurrection. This is our script that we have invented out of thin air. So sure, an institution can arise that just affirms our script. Say, oh yeah, of course our script is right. Yeah. And let's all just, you know, hang together and keep reaffirming that this script is true and it's going to work. And so, this is what happens here. And people here say, well, you got to have an authentic death. That's what you're here for. You can't be talking about, you know, non-dual abidance or vision of oneness, pretending to be eternal life. So that doesn't help with authentic death. What you came here for is authentic death, and we know how to help you out with that. Just follow our lead, and we'll make sure you get a tombstone, and then you're in limbo or purgatory. I guess, you know, purgatory, and don't worry, we'll send some money to the Pope, and we'll attend his, you know, family fest or whatever, and by doing so we're going to dedicate it to you, and you get 5 years less purgatory. It's closer to what? I mean, I'm not sure. I mean, because the end of purgatory has to be the resurrection ultimately, right? The resurrection into heaven. But that happens at some specific date according to the script we've scripted. So I mean, you got to stay in purgatory till then, don't you? So how does 5 years less in purgatory? Maybe you get out of purgatory and go into limbo, you know. But whatever. I mean, however we want to script it, our script here, it doesn't make any difference, really. But yeah, you come here and people say, "Oh yeah, we're experts at authentic death." And I said, "Really? Show me anyone who's died an authentic death." I say, well, Jesus says no. That was just an accommodation for the script. It wasn't a real death at all. It was just a pretending. It's not authentic death. I say, no, we got an authentic death. No, he didn't. What do you mean? I mean, everybody who's died is not authentic death? Yeah, that's right. There's never been one authentic death. There never will be. So get over yourself. You know, we put so much effort into it. Well, you know, no matter how much effort you put into it, it's all wasted effort. So you might as well stop putting effort into it. Sooner the better, right? It'll be even more regret if you keep trying to put effort into it. And they might say, well, that's an atheistic position. No, it isn't. The God of guilt is doesn't exist. That's not an atheistic position. Saying the God of guilt that we invented is non-existent, that's not atheism, that's theism, because I'm, you know, pointing what the true God is, which is the true creator, true prime creator, created us as eternal life, eternal freedom, and that's the one and only God there is. There's not a God of judgment and guilt at all. And of course, monotheism, you know, is the mistake of claiming that the God of guilt and judgment is the only God there is, and trying to get rid of the true God. To know there's only one God, you're bringing up another one. No, not bringing up. I'm bringing up the one and only true one, and saying the God of guilt and judgment is a complete fantasy on our part. So docetism, theism, those are all valid, but the ego's tried to turn them upside down on us and trap us in this upside down position. If we assert the true God, it says, "Wait, you believe in two gods?" No, I believe in the one true God, and the fake God is a fake God. So it's not dualism, not two gods at all. It's not dualism. It's the ego by believing in a fake God. That's the one that's really believing in dualism. There's only one God, and that's the God of eternal life. There is only one God, and that's the God of eternal life. How are we doing? Pretty good here. Yeah. Feeling a little lazy here, the summer afternoon. But it's the strain and the stress of all this is the thing. It's not easy to admonish the entire world. Because you feel, wow, you know, the whole world's going to be upset with you. Nobody likes to be admonished, except the repentant. The repentant love to be admonished, you know, in the right way. Say, oh, thank you. Thank you for the admonishment. Yeah, that's helpful. But those who are stuck into a corner, very defensive, they don't like being admonished. Because they think they have to please the ego to get out of the corner. And of course the ego hates being admonished. But once you just put the ego in its place and throw it off its stride, throw it off balance, you know, spiritual jujitsu, throw the ego off balance, then you don't have to please the ego to get out of the corner. Once you're out of the corner, then, you know, it's like, wow, yeah, being admonished is wonderful. It means being reminded, really. And being admonished is being given a reminder. How are we doing on the time? Let me see. Well, to go to church or not go to church, you know, having seen the church edge is completely finished. It's curtains. Well, I guess I'll go and see if they lynch me, mob descends upon me. No, I won't allow for it. I will not make that accommodation. I found out that my life has just been making accommodations for people, and they get so used to that, they demand more and more and more. But remember, these are temporary accommodations, and they're only accommodations to enable people to get started on the path, but they didn't keep their side of the bargain, you know. They just said, no, we want more accommodations. Become accommodation addicts. And we can't have that. That's why Jesus came back. I said, Jesus, nobody's going to pay attention to you. He says, well, I'm coming back anyway. I'm not going to... I got to show you tough love that I'm, you know, you can't be accommodation addicts. That I only made the accommodation so that you could get working, not so you could just turn into an accommodation addict. So the accommodation addicts, you know, they'll miss the boat. And he says, okay, well done. And that, you know, make this a teachable moment. You know, accommodation is a temporary situation, a temporary expedient, not a permanent refuge. It's a temporary expedient. Yeah, we make accommodations for children, right? But the children cannot keep asking for accommodations, or you turn into a princess. You know, the princess culture is just saying, you got to, like the children, you got to keep accommodating me, more accommodation, more accommodation. This is the lipstick princess culture we have, is just, you know, blank check, more accommodations, no end to it. And initially we say, okay, yeah, make accommodations, but you got to, you know, do the work that this accommodations, you know, enable you to at least get going. And if you don't do it, then, you know, we're not going to keep extending more accommodations. So Jesus is already back. I've already related with him, and there's no, you know, there's no extraordinary accommodations like before. He says, well, I'm here to relate with you as a friend. That you can say that's some minor accommodation in some way, but that's it. There isn't any more accommodations. So that means he expects us to have our game ready, you know, to be prepared. That's what he said in all the Gospels. You better be prepared for when I return. You better be prepared. So many of the parables and the stories, the various things he gave out, were teaching lessons. We're talking about, you know, don't be foolish like these people who don't prepare. Be wise and smart like these ones who do prepare. Because you, in the hour that I return, you don't know when the Son of Man is coming back. You don't know when the master of the house is coming back. You don't know when these things will fall upon you. So you had better prepare, so that you're not caught in disarray, and the master of the house say, ah, oh, look what you did. You squandered, you know, my legacy here. I told you to take good care of it, and you squandered it all away. So the door is closed to you. Wailing and gnashing of teeth. This is what Jesus warned us about. I don't know what people are thinking in this world. That we have to prepare. That's taking up the challenge. If someone says they're a Christian, then every day they've got to be trying to go really big. Or if anyone's any, see themselves as on the spiritual path at all, you have to go big. Don't have to say that you're on the path of Jesus, but you have to go big. You have to prepare, because the various cycles that happen, the apocalypse is now, the tribulation is coming up very soon, and you cannot just insist on being an accommodation addict. That won't help you at this point. And there's some that just make a living out and say, oh, will you accommodate me? Oh, thank you. You're so wonderful. Oh, will you accommodate me? Oh, thank you. And that's all they do, is just say, hey, I need to be accommodated. And sometimes people who are handicapped their whole life, they're experts in this. And you say, well, they need to be. Well, how do you know what's the cart and what's the horse? Maybe their whole scheme is to say, hey, I want to become expert in, I'm an accommodation addict, but how can I get away with that? Oh, I'll be in a wheelchair my whole life, and so people feel sorry for me, and I can get away with it. Whereas Jesus would say to them, get up and walk, right? Did Jesus accommodate all the sick people, or did he say, get up and walk? The paralyzed one, who today would be in a wheelchair, he'd say, get up and walk. You don't need the wheelchair anymore. Get up and walk. In other words, you know, I've done as much accommodation as I'm going to do. I did make an extreme accommodation for your script. So now it's time for you to get working on my, you know, your part of the, fulfilling your part of the bargain. I fulfilled mine by making it accommodating your script to a severe extent. So it's now up for you to accommodate the spiritual effort and learn the lessons you have to learn. So get up out of the wheelchair and walk. But we have experienced some people that, you know, have been handicapped, they expect you to, you know, do whatever they ask you to do. They cry, oh, I can't help out. Okay, and, you know, in other words, suspend all your plans and accommodate whatever they ask you to do. Not all of them are that way. I mean, not at all. But you know what I'm talking about. When you talk about a certain syndrome, use an example, you're not saying that it's everyone. So, you know, flush the PC lack of comprehension. Flush it, because that does not going to help you at all. That's just more, you know, accommodation addiction, right? You must accommodate my inability to accept you telling me that I need to stop being an accommodation addict. No, we don't. No, we don't. Jesus is not doing that. So even though I said, oh, who's going to listen to you? He says, I'm still coming back. Tough love right there. Said, I'm not waiting. It just fuels this accommodation addiction. People have to learn. We have spirit has to learn. That's being an accommodation addict is not the way to go. That will never succeed. So make sure you get a lot of rest. That is super important. I try to take a couple of naps a day, really. Sometimes I'll sleep a couple of hours, or, you know, whatever I can get. And then I bounce back and I feel like I can really make another push. But this is tough, tough stuff. You talk about stress reaction. You don't want to be post-traumatic stress syndrome. The problem with war is you never get chance to come down from the wow. See, this is why there's so much damage in the psyche from war. The warriors come back and they never had an opportunity. You know, every day for them there's a lot of wow, and they need to know how to meditatively deal with that. I mean, the military is in need of this sort of spiritual practice more than anybody. the warriors that go to war, I mean, they just get hit horrible. They come back home and they're wiped. I feel for them. I recognize that there's so many homeless who are veterans, actually, because they have post-traumatic stress syndrome. That's a real thing. That is a real terrible syndrome. They're burned out. They can't keep their mind stopped because they just got pushed too hard. I mean, they used energy drinks. They use pills. They use, you know, whatever. Peer pressure, you name it. To push, go, and experiencing horrific wows all the time. Shock. And they just use the youth, you know, to keep going. But that's still, they're still traumatized in their minds. They've been overloaded, you see. Whereas if they really need, you know, every day they need to de-stress. And once a week they need time off. But in a battle, you know, sometimes they don't get that. Especially in the big wars like World War II, holy cow. I mean, this was all in. Everybody was all in. And I mean, like for instance, the Germans introduced methamphetamine to their troops. And their troops, you know, were just like, go. They couldn't stop. Devastated German troops. And of course, Americans got it from them and used speed and various stuff, cigarettes, coffee, and uppers to keep fighting too. After the war, a lot of the German soldiers were like zombies. I mean, they just put them in huge concentration camps, prisoner of war camps, all over Eastern Europe, all over the place, and basically neglected them. I mean, how many millions of German soldiers died in these prison camps after the war? Nobody really paid any attention to it. Yeah, they were burned out, severely burned out. They didn't even care. A lot of them at that point didn't even care whether they lived or died, actually. This post-traumatic stress syndrome. Too much. Wow. Now you might say it's a negative wow, but really, it can be a teachable moment, all this stuff. You see, like, what's going on is, well, wow, this world, you know, everybody's like trying to, you know, die. I mean, what's going on? Actually, in warriors get a lot of authentic wows, actually. Some of them even have breakthroughs and, you know, moments of enlightenment. Because the intensity, you know, it's so intense and vivid, and you're seeing, you know, it's unmasked. You see a lot of it's unmasked, very apocalyptic in nature. And so, you know, we should not just, reject just because someone's a warrior doesn't mean they're not a spirit and that they cannot be actually on a spiritual path even during warfare and being a warrior. Absolutely they can. Maybe even as much as anybody. But they have to be able to use the right technique, and as far as I know, they're not. And so that, you know, these techniques could be utilized to help them de-stress. It's just I'm in this full stop in the neutral mode, where they're not a robot following orders. They're just saying, I'm neither responding to orders, nor am I not responding to orders. You know, so they need to be this, like, they should have this zone, this place where they go after battle, and where they're now in this neutral zone, right? In the neutral zone. And they're not, I'm neither responding, nor am I not responding. I'm neither a warrior, nor am I not a warrior. I'm both a warrior and not a warrior. And I'm neither a warrior nor not a warrior. you know, where they're allowed to center them, center in spirit. They should have the allowance. Why not? You know, this is extraordinarily difficult work. Everybody should be allowed that in their work. Of course, they don't allow that because this goes away from authentic death, trying to attain authentic death. You see a lot of these veterans, and what were they trying to do? Attain an authentic death. You know, now they're like homeless and complete drug addicts and just dying. And you say, oh wow, you know, maybe that's an authentic death. Or, you know, no, but that's what they're aiming for. They have to realize the baseline is that there's no such thing as an authentic death. Once that's accepted as the baseline, all society will change. And people will start centering in this, you know, neutral zone technique, a full stop in the wow. I'm neither centered nor not centered. You can say that too. I'm neither in the world nor not in the world. I'm neither focused on the world nor not focused on the world. I'm neither practicing nor not practicing. So this has caused a severe wow reaction. I can feel it. So to determine where you're at, just try to be neutral for a moment. Just feel like a neutrality, and then you can become aware of just how you're, there's sort of like a very intense, you know, inner reverberation. There's a lot going on just beneath the surface. This is the wow. Like you're kind of like alarmed and part elation, part trepidation. So I'm neither alarmed nor not alarmed. I'm neither upset nor not upset. I'm both upset and not upset. You can use either the neither or the both form, whichever either you like, or switch back and forth. I'm both alarmed and not alarmed. So as soon as I said that, I felt relaxation somehow. The intensity dropped. I'm both in very intense and not very intense. I'm both intense and not intense. I'm both reverberating and not reverberating. I'm both in shock and not in shock. When you do this, then you're able to feel the wow. I can feel it. It's like, oh my gosh, this is very strong. So let me just take some time here to use this technique and full stop in the wow. Calm down. I'm both calm and not calm. I'm both tired and not tired. I'm both freaking out and not freaking out. I'm both astonished and not astonished. I'm both agitated and not agitated. So we might have to spend 10, 15, 20 minutes sometimes at calming down. Maybe half an hour. Maybe sometimes an hour. Depends. But that is the time extremely well spent, and it's essential. Otherwise, fixation is coming. Defensiveness is coming. You're going to lose your momentum. And before you know it, you're going to start to overcompensate for all of this. And before you know it, you've become a bit eccentric, and then you get defensive over that, and it's a downward spiral. Then you get some addiction to try and feel expansive again, and the spiral goes down like that. Now, of course, the yoga teacher tells, take a deep breath. That never worked for me. It doesn't really work. You know, it's trying to force expansiveness. The deep breath happens automatically when you do this technique of both. And it will feel genuine. You feel how genuine it is. Like, it really does relax you. It's tremendous. And we're so frustrated being stuck in all this that we look for relaxation experts, and then that's the sex, drugs, rock and roll experts. You say, oh yeah, I'm an expert at that. And then they, of course, ask for a tremendous amount in return. Thinking but that's again trying to force relaxation. The real problem is the ego, and you're still cornered by it, so it doesn't really work at all. The only real therapy is spiritual therapy. That is a fact. So don't waste time on the other. The discipline to hold yourself in this full stop and the wow, that's the true therapy, and that's what really enables you to then get out of that corner and push back against the ego and make your assertions, which is really pushing back. And when you get the upper hand, you push back and push the ego away. You say, hey, you're not going to fixate me here. I'm going all the way here. Yes, I already know I've already gone all the way. Yes, I already know that I have already gone all the way. Meaning you're dismissing all the ego's bluster. It can't stop you. So you're as good as all the way. If the ego's out of the picture, we're as good as all is done, right? So, yes, I already know I'm already done. Yes, I already know I'm already done. Yes, I already know that I'm already done. Yes, I already know that I'm already done. So speaking of being done, maybe we need to wrap this one up. And so again, remember, go big. Where am I at with the wow? Where am I at with the wow? Check in. I'm neither checking in or not checking in. I'm neither this nor that. I'm both checking in and not checking in. Start using this technique. Then this will enable you to become aware of the wow. You become aware of the wow. Once you become aware of it, then you say, oh, wow, I need to consciously calm this down. Let me bring it to light consciously and use this technique of full stop, and you will relax and you'll feel unstuck, and you're no longer cornered, you're no longer defensive. And just keep doing this, and all these complexes will dissolve. They will all dissolve gradually. They will dissolve. Okay. Very great. That's it for this one. And